one of the viewers pointed out, not incorrectly, that one definition of return on asset, so this whole video is going to be on return on asset, that one definition of return on asset, and if you look it up on some of the finance sites or even some finance textbooks, they'll tell you is net income over total assets, which is different from what I told you. And other sources, namely Wikipedia, will tell you that it is actually, so this is one definition of return on asset. Another definition is net income. I'll just abbreviate that as N.I. Net income plus interest. So they're adding back your interest. And then they're subtracting out the tax savings due to interest. Minus tax savings due to interest, tax savings from interest. And we could do a whole video on the tax savings from interest and when it makes more sense to raise money with debt versus equity because of the cost of interest. But that also increases your chance of bankruptcy the more debt you take on. We could do a series of videos on that. But tax savings from interest divided by assets. This is the definition that Wikipedia gives you. And then I gave you the very first definition I gave you was operating profit over assets. And then I'll add one more definition to this video just because I think it's worth talking about. And I think this is kind of a general theme in finance, is that there's all these formulas for things and people, you know, memorize them. But in the process, you lose a lot of the intuition. And it's also important to realize that there are multiple ways of defining the exact same term. So people can confidently say, oh, the ROA is this. And you know what? It's never a bad question to ask them what they mean by ROA. And I think you'd also be surprised by how many people won't be able to tell you what they mean by ROA. But the last one, if I have time to go over, we'll call it EBIT. I know that looks like a very strange word, EBIT divided by assets. But just so you know what EBIT is just earnings before interest and taxes. So this is just the same thing as income, net income, plus interest, plus taxes. So it's kind of a pre-tax ROA divided by assets. So these are all different things. And you might already say, wait, if I took net income, let's actually talk about this for a second. Let's compare EBIT to operating profit. You might immediately say, if I took net income, so EBIT, let's remember, EBIT, it's just an acronym for earnings before interest and taxes. So let's see, if our earnings are $350,000, and we were to add back the taxes and the interest, we add back the taxes, gets us to pre-tax, and we add back to the interest, we get to, at least in this example, we get to an operating profit number. So you might say, why is there a different term, EBIT, instead of why don't people just always use operating profit? And the reason why there's a different term is sometimes you can have non-operating profit. So let's say that out of this $10 million of assets, and I didn't go there in the first example because I didn't really want to complicate the issue, but I'll complicate the issue a little bit now. Let's say out of this $10 million of assets, let's say that $9 million are kind of operating assets. They're the enterprise. They're the things that are needed to generate the operating profit. And then you had another $1 million of assets that of this $10 million that is just, you know, the company really doesn't need it to operate. They just have it around. Maybe they're speculating on oil prices, or they're just hedging something, or they just have a super flush bank account. So these assets might be generating non-operating income. So you could say, you could have a line here for interest income or investment income. Let me put that, investment income. And then the company might have made some money there. It might have made, I don't know, might make $10,000 on investment income. And of course, that'll drop to this line. This will then become $510,000. The taxes will be $153,000. And the net income is what, like $356,000 or something along those. $357,000 actually. $357,000 because we have a 30% tax rate. And that makes sense, right? I added an extra $10,000 of income here. And at the end of the day, you're going to tax it at 30%. So it should be $7,000 more of earnings, so that makes sense, $357,000. But this is the difference between operating income and EBIT. EBIT, in this case, would be the operating profit plus this investment income. So EBIT, in the case that I just added some investment income, would be, you know, $1,010,000, while operating profit would be $1 million. I didn't want to go there in the first video, and that's why I just said operating profit divided by assets. But if you really consider all of the assets, and if you assume that there are some assets there that are non-operating, that they're just they're not really used to make widgets or to sell widgets or market widgets or help the CEO in any way kind of do his job or her job, then whatever this generates is actually non-operating income. And so EBIT factors that in. So EBIT, I kind of view it, it goes backwards. It starts with net income, and then it adds back the taxes and interest. While operating profit, you start at the top line, and you go down. But in general, if you take EBIT and you take out the non-operating income, you get back to operating profit. So that's what EBIT is right here. And so you can already imagine that both EBIT and the way I defined it initially, operating profit divided by assets, they're ways of saying, before you consider taxes, what are your assets doing for you? So once again, if this is a balance sheet, this is the assets. Here are your liabilities. Debt could be one of them, but you know, in general, these are your. It could be a bunch of other things. You might owe other vendors money or whatever. And then you have your equity. It's important whenever you talk about any of these ratios. You know, what context are you trying to pass the CFA exam? Or are you trying to impress your MBA professor? Or are you trying to get an intuition for helping you become a better investor? And I like to, well, you know, if you are an investor, you're probably going to want to do the last of the three. And there, ROA is telling you, the return on assets is telling you, how good is this company at getting a return out of this thing right here? I don't care how they paid for it, whether they had debt. I don't want to think about, are they good at getting low interest? I don't want to think about, is their CFO good at getting a better interest rate than another CFO? Or are they better at evading taxes than another company? All I care is the assets that they have. How good are they at putting those assets to work? And what type of a return can they get? So if I calculate it using EBIT divided by assets, or operating profit divided by assets, if I use this as either of these as my metric for ROA, and I have company A has a 10% ROA, and company B has a 15% ROA, then I say, you know what, I don't care whether B's guy is better at getting a low interest rate or getting some type of tax handout from the government or doing something fancy with you know where he keeps his subsidiaries. I just want to know which management is better at getting a return out of these assets. And these metrics will tell you that, right? Because it tells you either how much operating profit is being generated from here, or it could tell you how much EBIT, in case an EBIT might be a little bit more informative, because there might be some of this income might be generated from non-operating assets. So, you know, some maybe the company holds some stock or it holds some gold or something, or it holds some forward contracts to hedge its exposure to oil or foreign currency or something. So in general, if you want to know what I think is the best ROA, I would say it's EBIT over assets, which is very close to operating profit over assets. And now you say, well, Sal, why are these other things here? And why don't you like them as much? Well, net income over assets, I think the reason why that definition exists is because, one, net income, it does factor in these things that, frankly, I didn't want to think as much about. But in terms of, you know, when you talk about return, what you get off the asset, you still are going to pay taxes on them. And if you do have some financing, you will be paying some interest on that. So that's why this comes out, where they actually just take the bottom line. They take the, you know, when people talk about top line and bottom line, now you know where those words come from. Top line is revenue. It's the top line of the income statement. And your bottom line, that's the bottom line of the income statement. That's where the word comes from. So that one definition takes this, and they divide by the total assets. But the reason why I don't like that, is because it doesn't separate out. This definition does not separate out that one company might be better at evading taxes or paying taxes, and another company might be better at somehow getting better financing from the bank. And that's not what matters. I care about the assets I care just about the left-hand side of the balance sheet, while this is taking into consideration some of the factors on that side of the balance sheet. For example, you could have company A. Let's say you have two identical companies. This could be an interesting example. You have one company. Whoops. Actually, I just realized I'm out of time. I'll continue the example in the next video, and I'll explain a little bit about the interest tax saving from interest as well. Or sorry, the tax saving from carrying debt or from interest. See you in the next video.